Hello, Mr. Butcher, and thank you very much for being with us in this morning. I will start with a question that everyone is asking you. You are closing to the end of your term here in Romania, but who's going to be the next U.S. ambassador, Mr. Butcher?
Well, yeah, sadly, I am coming to the end of my nearly 3 years here. It's really been a wonderful ride, and I'm awfully sad to be leaving now. Every time you think about it, there's always something exciting going on here. I still cannot tell you who the new American ambassador will be. I know that Washington is working hard on identifying someone. I can tell you that on my departure, there will be a new chargé d'affaires, Dean Thompson, who will be arriving in July and will be taking up my position and will act as chargé until the new ambassador arrives.
So it's going to take some more time.
It will take some more time, but I have a sense that we are, you know, we have renewed effort and that we're working very hard on identifying an ambassador.
All right, let's tackle the hard issues, let's say. Can you provide, Mr. Butcher, an assessment of commitments made by the Ponta government during the Prime Minister's visit to Washington in October 2030, and the Romanian Prime Minister then at that time made a series of commitments regarding the state of law, non-interference with the judiciary and others. To what extent have these been complied with?
The meeting in October with Vice President Biden and the Prime Minister was a really good one, and the Vice President articulated very clearly just why it's so important for America as well as for Romania, for Romania to succeed. And succeeding will depend on the successful battle against corruption. He was very prescient in October. We didn't have any sense of how things would turn out in Ukraine, but one of the points he made was that it's important for Romania to succeed to serve as an example for the rest of the region, including Ukraine. And I think that when we see what happened in Ukraine and the decline of confidence in institutions, we see just why it's so important to continue this fight, to have strong independent institutions. And I believe that the Prime Minister very much understood that message, and that he, as you know, we've seen many public statements, that he understands that it's very important to continue the fight against corruption, both for America and for Romania.
Yeah, but someone could argue that we had a Black Tuesday after that. The majority tried to destroy the anti-corruption laws.
We're watching very closely to see where things go, and certainly we were very disappointed with those moves. But if you look at the totality of the actions taken by the government since the October meeting, I think that you have to say that this is not a bad record. That Romania has really made continued progress in fighting corruption, and we have hopes that will continue. We expect that it will continue.
Do you think that is it possible to have another Black Tuesday? Do you think that the government understood that they cannot go on this path?
I think that the international community and in fact Romania itself made it very clear just how disappointing it would be to see more moves made to try to raise some people above the law or to provide anything that separates classes of people that moves away from equal treatment under the law.
So how would you assess the readiness, the will of the government and the parliamentary majority to support the fight against corruption?
We've reinforced the importance of fighting corruption, of strong independent institutions continually, as everyone will have seen when Vice President Biden was here and spoke so eloquently and probably made the most convincing and clear articulation of our position in fighting corruption to an extremely influential audience of young and, you know, of Romanians of all ages, of influential politicians, youth leaders, rule of law representatives. And I think that message was reinforced later by both Senate visits that we had, by the Secretary of Defense. I think that it's very clear to the Parliament, to the majority, to everyone in Parliament and to the government, just how important it is that the fight for, against corruption and for rule of law continue.
It's important to do that, but we still have problems here, and officials of the Department of Justice, the team of U.S. senators who visited Romania recently, have sharply criticized the immunity Romanian MPs take advantage of in case of arrest retention or search warrants. But the issue is very complicated, as you may know, considering that a change to the Constitution may lead to this kind of immunity being dropped. And in this case, what solution can you see to the issue of elected officials' immunity? What had better do what?
I'm not equipped to prescribe actual measures for legal reform, specific measures that would be appropriate in the Romanian context. But what I can say is that this idea of immunity is very foreign to the United States, and it's something that strikes our senators, our prosecutors, our judges when they visit. They notice this and they're surprised. As far as what could be done, one very clear step that could be taken would be that Parliament could vote to lift immunity and let the various people who have been charged see their day in court and have the courts determine their guilt or innocence. That would be a step. Another interim step could be a decision to make public the vote for who's voting for and against immunity, and that would, I think, be a relatively easy step. But I would like to see, it's for Romania to decide, but I think for Americans what we would see as more normal would be a much more restricted immunity that applies to statements made on the floor of the legislative house, and similar. That's what we consider appropriate. We think it's very important that no citizen be above the law.
So transparency would be
Transparency would be an outstanding interim step, and I know there are moves afoot to encourage that.
Right. Okay, after the Ponta-Biden meeting in October 2013, the White House issues a press release saying, quote, "The two leaders also agreed on the importance of expanding trade and investment between our two countries and welcomed support for the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership negotiations, which has the potential to generate significant increases in the already substantial number of jobs supported by US-EU trade and investment." In this regard, how do you assess Romania's support for TTIP?
Romania is one of the strongest supporters within the Union for TTIP. We are anticipating that they'll continue to be very strong supporters as we get into the very difficult part of the negotiations. And one thing about Romania that may be unique is that I don't believe there's much debate here about that. I get the sense that across the many parties that there's a pretty uniform support for moving towards TTIP. That's something we appreciate greatly.
That's very good news, but we have at least interesting detail here. Romania has a strategic partnership with the US. Romania is a support of TTIP, but Romania's state control airline Tarom has no direct flight to US. Meanwhile, the Ponta government has shown interest in launching two flights to China. We do not have a strategic partners with China via Tarom. Do you think a direct airline link with the US is needed?
I would never judge the strength of a partnership based on an airline schedule. I assume that those decisions would be made for business reasons and based on connections and what market was being served. That's very easy to get from here to the United States. I would prefer, when we look at the quality of the strategic partnership, to look at the way that Romania and the United States work together in the international stage, in the United Nations, in the European Union councils, in geopolitics, to look at the military engagement, to look at the Romanian support for NATO in Afghanistan or fighting piracy in the Indian Ocean, or the many, many troops who are transiting through Mihai Călgălnicianu on their way home from Afghanistan, or the missile defense base being built in Devasello. I think that if you look at that, this is a really very robust partnership. And I think that a choice of scheduling is really something quite irrelevant.
But it could bother ordinary people. I mean, ordinary people, I met some guys coming from the US saying that it's outrageous that Romania do not have a direct line with the US.
I would be reluctant to schedule flights based on political concerns. I think this really has to be based on how the market is served. The transatlantic market is a huge one, and there are a lot of different airlines in that market flying people from across the Atlantic. And I assume that Tarom is capable and that is always making a calculation about whether it's worth flying to the United States, whether the market is there, whether they can compete adequately. And if they feel that the routes east are more commercially viable, then that I think it would be reasonable that they would go that direction.
Going back a little bit to anti-corruption theme, Vice President Biden and other top U.S. officials have warned about the risk oligarchs in Eastern Europe pose to democracy, with clear hints towards Romania and Bulgaria. Those two countries were mentioned in all speeches. One of these oligarchs, Sebastian Ghiță, has told Hot News in a recent interview he wanted to strip away this sort of oligarchic influence and admitted that his change of position comes in the context of these signals sent by US officials. How credible is his gesture in your eyes?
We have frequently expressed our concern about too much power involved in the media in Romania being concentrated in too few hands and too much interference in media from business interests. And I think we welcome any move which takes us in the direction of an independent and a professional media environment.
But do you believe him when he say
I can't comment on any individual's particular motives.
Would you include someone like Sebastian Ghiță in the category of oligarchs who may threaten democracy?
I would be very reluctant to make to throw out a name like that about anyone.
All right. Let's go further with a Stratfor agency circulated the following scenario a week ago. I quote, "We see the United States being to adopt a Black Sea strategy centered on Romania. The Russians held on to Sevastopol because naval capability in the Black Sea is critical. A strategy that enhances Romania's naval capability and places US aircraft in the region would pose a threat to the Russian fleet. It would also extend defensive capabilities to Georgia and protect the indispensable route for any pipelines running from Azerbaijan. Put simply, a competent rival Black Sea fleet would create problems for Russia, particularly if the Ukraine regime survives and Crimea is isolated." What are your comments on this Stratfor scenario?
I think that Mr. Friedman is an interesting and thought-provoking voice as far as approaching strategy in the region, but I think it's very important to remember that he's not speaking for the United States and that this is not that what Mr. Friedman is writing does not reflect U.S. strategy or U.S. policy. Or it does not necessarily reflect U.S. policy or strategy.
So I understood that you cannot elaborate on this.
I think that right now what we're concentrating on in the region is assurance measures to demonstrate to everyone just how secure all of NATO is and how ready the members of the alliance are to protect the members of that border the regions of where there is unrest.
Europe fears a new gas crisis similar to that of 2009 after Russia decided to cut deliveries to Ukraine. And in this context, should Romania hurry up with the shale gas exploration activities in hopes of reaching an exploitation phase?
Since many months before the actual crisis developed in Ukraine the way it did, it's been clear that Romania can play an important role in assuring better energy security for Europe. And this certainly includes developing or looking at developing unconventional gas. It also includes improving transit and looking at offshore, looking at economies and modernizing transit. Also includes renewable energy and a lot of other sources. But I think that it's important that all European countries, and especially Romania, given its history, look at all the ways they can work to improve energy security.
Do you think what is happening in Ukraine, in Russia, will speed up searching for and also exploiting shale gas?
I think at this point we're in a position where this is based much more on technical challenges, on dealing with engineering challenges, and so I'm not sure that political concerns are likely to actually speed things up, but I think that certainly the events now with learning that gas to Ukraine may be cut off, I would think this would be a factor in a decision made at the point that Romania has to decide whether to exploit shale gas.
We are reaching the end of this interview, Mr. Bacha, and I will kindly ask you to assess a little bit this region, this country especially, that you lived for a couple of years. When you live back in Washington, what is in your mind? The image about this country. Is Romania close to an Eastern model of democracy, such as Turkey, let's say, or to the Western model?
I mean, I don't think that democracy is Eastern or Western. I think that that there's well there are a lot of, there are certainly a lot of democracies in Western Europe. This is democracy is good for everyone. And but I will also say I think it's clear to me that Romania is very firmly rooted in the Western tradition. That this is a European country that belongs in Europe, and I expect it is developing and will develop very much along the lines of other countries farther to the west. I think that Romanians, as I reflect, Romanians are a little hard on themselves sometimes, and maybe that's to their benefit. I think a lot of the time people here don't see the progress that's being made, that we worry about the challenges in front of us, or we worry about protecting the progress, and we don't sometimes sit back and think just how far this place has come in 25 years, and really what just how much progress has been made. I think it's important sometimes for Romanians to sit back and say, we're actually doing pretty well. We've really made some good progress. And when you look around, you can see that there's really a lot here to be proud of. That's not to say that anyone can sit back and stop working. It's important that the progress be protected and that it be continued. But as I leave here, it is with optimism and with a sense of appreciation and admiration for the people here who have been responsible for that progress, because it's clear nothing's easy. And no one just got rich because they joined the union, that there was a lot of hard work done here and it continues to be done. And there are a lot of heroes here. And I guess what I will take away from Romania is the crusading journalists, the members of the different agencies, the prosecutors, the judges, the people here who are fighting to make Romania a better place and to really ensure that Romania finds its place in the community of Western prosperous democracies. I think that's heroism. It's something that I will always remember, and I've been privileged to be exposed to the people involved in that fight.
Thank you very much for this interview, Mr. Bacsa.